Hi, everybody. My name is Brad, and I'm here to talk to you a little about privacy. So I just, quick caveat, my views are expressed are my own, not either of my employers, so impute the crazy only to me. So I want to talk to you a little bit about how privacy is changing, and how the ways that we think about what is private have started to morph, and where I think it's going. And so my premise to you is we've gone from a society of privacy laws to privacy norms, and that we can encapsulate this with a simple phrase of not cool bro, or broette, or whatever the proper term is, as the case may be. So now, you're gonna ask, what do I mean when I say not cool bro? So when I say not cool bro, I'll give you an example. You're on Facebook, and you have a bad breakup or fight with one of your friends, and you block that person so they can no longer see your wall. Someone else who still has access to your Facebook wall goes in and either copies and pastes the entire thing or takes a screenshot every day and mails it to that person. Okay, so our initial response is, okay, that's not cool. Not cool, bro. Not cool. We get the visceral feeling that that's somehow a privacy violation. We get the feeling that that's something unseemly is happening, but we don't know how to quite talk about it. And this is what I'm talking about by not cool, bro, privacy, because the law doesn't recognize that as a real privacy interest. So it first makes a little sense to talk about what the law does recognize. And most of our privacy comes from the criminal context. Old privacy was literally, you had to sneak up to someone's house and eavesdrop. So the eaves of a house are where the water falls. So you would stand outside and you would listen. You know, you'd climb over their fence, shimmy across their lawn, nuzzle up to the side of the house, maybe like, you know, poke a hole in a window, and then you could eavesdrop. That's what you had to do to violate someone's privacy. So privacy was really about access to information. And we didn't need special rules regulating access to information because you couldn't violate someone's privacy in the 1700s unless you showed up at their front gate, right? There was no Facebook. The only wall that happened in 1700 was literally the wall outside the carriage house. So we go from that to this modern era, or a pre-modern era, in which we have ways of getting information that don't necessarily involve the traditional structures of space. So there's a very famous case involving a guy who walks into the phone booth, and he closes the door behind him, and then he does some illegal activity, and the police are listening, and they don't have a warrant. And by the way, in the law, you need to get a warrant before you can listen to any of this stuff. And for those of you who've seen CSI or Law and Order, the judges who give out warrants are sometimes like Oprah, you get a warrant, and you get a warrant, and everybody gets a warrant. But at least we still have that nominal process, that the privacy is still being protected, right? There's a reasonableness here. Well, this guy, and his name is Katz, so you can have all sorts of fun with it, spelled with a K. He had a reasonable expectation of privacy, of two types. It was subjective, meaning he personally believed it was private because he closed the booth behind him. And then two, objective. Society as a whole is willing to say, you know what, yeah, if you go into a telephone booth and close the door, that should be private. Now, what about if we apply this to Facebook, right? This is the not cool bro version of privacy. You just take it one more step. In the old version of privacy, it's all about control over the means of accessing information. In the new version of privacy, it's all about control over who can get the information that you give it to. Right? So in the old version of privacy, if I tell someone, hey, I got an F on a test, that person can tell anyone else, and it's not really considered a violation of privacy. I didn't keep it private because I allowed someone else access. In the new version of privacy, when you post something to your Facebook wall, if you've prevented the rest of the world from seeing it, is there an implied understanding to anyone else you've given access to that they shouldn't reshare it? Or another example, if you're on Twitter, and you've got a protected Twitter stream that no one can see unless they expressly follow you and you allow them, and someone just started retweeting all of your protected tweets, you'd say the exact same thing. But the understanding would have been, wait a minute, I only let you see my Twitter stream because I thought you weren't going to retweet it. You violated some sort of implied understanding we had. So now we have our modern eavesdropper who's in your Facebook wall posting again, right? So this is our modern eavesdropper overhearing conversation. So how do we get to a place in which the law can come up to where we are, right? Because we think of this new norm, this new idea that our norms of you won't reshare something I only share with you, how do we get there? And there's actually an interesting way. And I'll take it back a little bit to give you an example. When Facebook started out, you had to be a member of a network to just look at someone's profile. And I remember having a job where someone in HR knew that I went to Yale and sent me an email and said, Brad, we know you went to Yale. Could you log into Facebook and print out a copy of this applicant's Facebook page? We'd like to see it. So by the way, for those of you who thought this didn't happen, it was happening in 2004, so you better believe it's happening now. That said, I recoiled in like shock and horror, and I was like, that would be a violation of that person's privacy, it would be betrayal of trust. But the idea was back then, it was like what happened in the Yale network stayed in the Yale network. It was kind of like Vegas. And so there was a knowledge that it was like, hey, not cool, bro. You knew that you only had access to this. There was a reciprocal understanding. You won't tell other people what goes on in the Yale network, and I won't tell other people what goes on in the Yale network. And so if you think about it, there's an implied commitment when you join any of these social networks that if you're not supposed to reshare information, you won't. And there's another area of the law that actually has already had this transformation where they went from a very formal, there have to be explicit understandings to just anything goes, and that's products liability. As crazy as it may sound, there was a time where if you bought a can of Coca-Cola and it blew up in your hand as you were drinking it, the only person you could sue is the bodega or bodeguois, as the case may be, that you bought it from. And over time, courts sort of didn't like this. They said, well, there's an implied contract between the original manufacturer and each step in the chain of distribution, such that the ultimate consumer does not need to be in contractual privity with the original manufacturer, which is a fancy way of saying, we're going to say that there's an implied contract that runs all the way through all these steps in the middle, and when you finally buy that can of Coke, you get an implied contract from Coke. Finally, a court in California said, enough is enough. We're done pretending. We're done making up these implied contracts. We're just going to say, strict liability applies. If you make a product and you put it out in the universe, you have a reasonable understanding that if somebody gets hurt by that product, they're going to sue you. We can do the exact same thing with privacy. If you join a social network, Facebook, Twitter, Google+, and you join that network knowing that there are privacy settings, and knowing that other people are sharing information with you, but at the same time prohibiting other people from accessing that information, it's a violation of whatever you want to phrase it as, but that person's express understanding that they would only share the information with you if you didn't reshare it. Now, we can get there without waiting. For example, Facebook could put a little lock or a hush icon on every post, on every element of Facebook that's been shared with you, that would let you know whether or not it was public, whether or not it was okay to reshare. Twitter already does this. You cannot one-click retweet a protected tweet. And Craigslist has code matching that will actually look at posts you've previously made, and if you're reposting similar content, it will stop you. Facebook and Twitter could do the exact same thing if they see you trying to use copy and paste to get around these mechanisms. The other thing they could do is we could amend our terms of service. We could make an express terms of service to reshare information that is not supposed to be reshared, like on Google+, where you can actually click disable resharing and then no one else can. So there's a sense that we can get there. We also can maybe get there in law. It won't necessarily happen right away, but in a recent case, the Supreme Court is starting to go there. In the Jones case, which dealt with GPS, Justice Sotomayor said, you know, maybe it's time that we start to rethink this notion that if you share something with one person, it is no longer private, because our societal expectations have changed. We've moved from law to norms. The norms of not cool bro to reshare are how we now think about privacy. And as a result, our law is lagging behind a little bit, and although we're not there yet with our laws, we have interim measures we can use from code. So the interesting thing to see is where we head now that we're a society of norms, and when we think about privacy as norm-based.